Good morning. Welcome to Mount Beulah Baptist Church and Fellowship Hall for a midweek Bible study. It is the middle of August. Public schools have started. We're sort of back to a normal schedule of life with our students at home. And so that is a little bit different. But for us at the church, we are moving forward with a regathering strategy. Sunday school regathering emphasis is moving forward. Our new church year will be starting in a couple weeks. Looking forward to that and the opportunity we have serving the Lord. So we are in our midweek Bible study. We are finishing up the book of 1 Peter today. So if you have your Bibles with me, if you'd like to turn to 1 Peter chapter 5, 1 Peter chapter 5, and we'll be looking at the final few verses of that letter that Peter has written to, in essence, his church members that are scattered abroad, that have been suffering. And he gives his final suffering summation. He sort of wraps up everything in these last few verses to help his readers, his church members, per se, the early Christians as they move forward. And so we are in 1 Peter chapter 5, if you turn with me there. Let me make one other note as we are moving forward with some things. Our goal, hopefully, very soon, is to potentially get our Sunday evening service back on course, as well as Sunday school starting back up September. With some modifications of room locations to accommodate the physical distancing that we are trying to do. And also, we will have communion in 2 weeks with some safety protocols in place, a little bit different look for that. But we are preparing to do that, planning to do that for our fifth Sunday in August. So again, thank you for continuing to pray for the ministry. Being involved in the ministry. Vacation Bible School was a couple weeks ago. It was great. A wonderful turnout of our students and a wonderful time to have our kids and students involved and many adults that have volunteered with that. And so we're moving forward a little bit different pace than normal, but very thankful to be able to do that. So here we are, 1 Peter chapter 5. We'll be looking at verses 8 through 14 specifically today. So if you have your Bible with you, you can follow along with me, or you can just listen as I read these verses in 1 Peter chapter 5, beginning with verse number 8. Probably a very familiar Bible verse. The Bible says, "Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion walketh about, seeking whom he may devour. Whom? Resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. But the God of all grace, who hath called us unto his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after that ye have suffered a while, will make you perfect or mature, establish you, strengthen you, and settle you. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen." And then Peter gives a personal touch. "By Silvanus, a faithful brother unto you, as I suppose, I have written briefly, exhorting and testifying that this is true grace of God wherein you stand. The church that is at Babylon, elected together with you, saluteth you, and so doth Marcus, my son. Greet ye one another with a kiss of charity. Peace be with you and all that are in Christ Jesus." Amen. Peter's suffering summation. Does all math add up? I am reminded of a story when I was a school teacher, a math teacher specifically, that all math equations don't always add up perfectly. If we were to say that it would take 12 men 2 days to build a house, could 24 men build a house in 1 day? And then could we say 48 men could build a house in 12 hours? Or if we were to add that together and say 96 men could build a house in 6 hours. And then if we were to add that up and double it, could a house be built in 3 hours or an hour and a half or 45 minutes? And the answer is no. That math does not always add up. I'm reminded of a story of how math doesn't always add up. There were three men that rented a hotel room. The total price was $90. They each paid $30 each. The manager noticed the room should have only cost $75. So he gave the $15 back to the customers. They tipped the manager $3 and they split the 12 among them. So they get $4 each. So they each paid $26 instead of the 30. And so if you take the 26 and you multiply it by 3, you end up getting the $78. You add the $3 tip, that makes it $81. So the question mathematically is, what happened to the other $9? And the truth of the matter is, well, some brilliant mathematician out there will try to explain it away to you, but when you have multiplication and addition working against each other, it doesn't always add up. For Peter, he is dealing with some suffering believers. Doesn't always add up. The early church suffered greatly, and it just didn't add up for them. It wasn't making sense. Peter, why are we going through this? We are celebrating Christ. We're Christians. We're following the love of God. We're loving others. We're trying to live as we should. And we are being persecuted. We're suffering. If you're familiar with our culture today and the world today, there's an organization called the Voice of Martyrs. And they explain worldwide where Christians are still being persecuted. And I know we as Americans don't always see that. We may even seem that it's extreme and it's not normal. And for us, it's not, but even recently, we have seen how government has tried to take control of shutting down gatherings of worship, and even in some states in the United States, trying to prohibit singing and praising the Lord. And then some churches rebelling and setting up their attorneys to fight for the freedom of worship, a constitutional right. Sometimes things just don't add up. And we come to this passage of Scripture for these suffering saints to be encouraged. Peter's final words start off in verses 8 and 9. He says, first of all, I want you to prepare yourself. Be prepared for these things. Now, I'll be honest with you. Some people prepare well. When we first thought of this COVID-19 and realizing the shutdown was going to come, my wife sent me to the store to buy food, to buy meat specifically, to buy chicken. When I got there, there wasn't much chicken at all. I bought some hamburger, I bought some ribs, I bought a few pieces of steak, which I really didn't know what I was doing because my wife does that. And eventually, we found some chicken, and we stocked a refrigerator and a freezer, preparing, not knowing what the transition would look like. I even had a church member that called me on a Tuesday morning at about 7:30 to tell me that Food Lion had chicken, and I went and bought some that day, very quickly, as a matter of fact. The truth of the matter is, some people prepare well, and here is Peter saying, okay, prepare yourself. He gives four positives. Be sober. Get your mind focused in the right direction. Be vigilant. Be alert. Be on guard. Security on the wall of a battle. Verse 9, he says, resist. That's a positive. Resist temptation. Resist the enemy. Take charge and be ready. And then he makes this statement, you are not alone. Many others are in this battle. The truth is, loneliness can be a challenge to us as believers. It can be a challenge to anybody, and especially during the pandemic that we are dealing with, loneliness becomes very real. Peter says, hey, let me just encourage you this way. Get your mind right. Gird up the loins of your mind. Really, just be prepared. Be alert. Be aware of what's going on around you. Accept the challenge and be ready. And then resist these other issues that might be in your life. Resist the temptations. And be encouraged. You're not alone. I'm reminded of the story of Elijah in the Old Testament when he begged God and pleaded that he was by himself. And God said, no, there were righteous men. You just didn't know where they were, but they're there. And for us, it's four positives. But then he brings us the negative that we need to be aware of as Christians, as suffering saints. It's the enemy. It's Satan himself as a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. Most people would say the lion roars after he has captured his prey and eaten it and he has accomplished it. He roars in success, and that is true, but there is another side of a roaring lion. It is that to scare the other animals. And when he roars, the animals will run quickly. And the fact is, they may actually run out in the open where the lion is so he can make it an easy prey. A roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. As Christians, we need to be aware of the traps that Satan put in front of us. His scared tactics of deceit. Well, they worked from the beginning. They worked on Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. He scared them into thinking that they were missing out. He deceived them. The truth is, Satan is still working on deceiving us as believers and causing problems for suffering saints. We can get in a position where our enemy, if we let him, well, he'll attack us and he'll win. Peter says, don't be like that. Be prepared. Be ready. Expect this suffering to happen. Expect Satan to attack. Now, I do believe some people have questioned the fact of, I'm just so small of a Christian, Satan's not going to bother me. And we can put that in perspective, that maybe Satan will only attack the men and women of God that God is using in what we would say in a great setting, maybe pastoring a large church or in a large ministry or having influence over many people, shepherding them. But here's the truth of the matter is, it's not only Satan. It's the fallen angels, a third of them. And if God could have called 10,000s of angels, well, then there's a lot of fallen angels as well that are working with Satan to deceive, as Satan does. We need to be prepared as Christians. The positives, be sober, be vigilant, resist, and realize we're not alone. The negatives, be aware that Satan is there and his scared tactics are there working today. And then Peter says, as you're prepared, understand the power that God has given us. Verse number 10, it's a beautiful transition. He transitions with, but the God of all grace, now that you have prepared yourself, now that you are there understanding your setting, now understand God's setting. You are prepared. Here's Satan, but here's God, the God of all grace. He's called us. unto eternal glory by Christ Jesus. After you suffer a while, he's going to restore you, make you perfect. He's going to establish you. He's going to strengthen you. He's going to settle you or support you. I tell you what, my God is more than sufficient. We can prepare ourselves. We need to do what we need to do to be prepared. I get it. And when Satan comes to attack, we need to be prepared for that and understand that and not be deceived. But if we check out the God of all grace, we have an old Baptist hymn called Amazing Grace. And I like to call it the Baptist hymn, but I'll be honest, I believe pretty much every denomination sings some form of Amazing Grace. God's amazing grace. We're so undeserving that he would show his grace, his mercy, and compassion to us. And Peter says, hey, the God of all grace and power is there. And he's the one that called you to do this. Guys, don't be worried about this. As Christians, you were called to do this. You were called to get through this persecution. You were called to get through this suffering. And sure enough, Peter encourages him and says, hey, the power of God has called you by Christ Jesus. You know, Christ came to earth. He suffered. Went to a cross. Died. But he rose again the third day. Eternal glory. And Peter says, hey, Christ is taking care of this. I know you're suffering a little bit, but it is all good and it is in control by the power of God. What's he going to do? You're going to suffer a little bit. I really sort of wish you didn't have to suffer, but we do. We go through this suffering and we come out different. And here's what Peter gives us and gives us this description and emphasizes this. Peter says, when you come out, he's going to make you, the King James Version, perfect or mature. You're going to grow up through this. And then he's going to establish you, going to get you set up someplace. He's going to strengthen you as you continue to grow in the Lord. Not only strengthen you, again, the King James Version says settle you. He's going to support you as you continue on. Let me promise you this. There is no greater support system than God himself. I appreciate the ministry I have at this church. I appreciate my leadership, the Sunday school teachers, the deacons, the men and women that serve here are tremendous support to this ministry. And the ministry here would not go on without them in this support role. But there is no greater support to Christian life than that of God. Especially when we're in a suffering period of time. We love to hear people praying for us. We love to hear people encouraging us, sending us notes, giving us phone calls. Absolutely. But God says, you know what? You come through your suffering. I'm going to mature you. I'm going to let you grow up. You're going to learn some things from this. I'm going to establish you. I'm going to get you settled. I'm going to support you through this. I'm going to strengthen you through this by the power of God as we are to be prepared. Peter says, check out God's power. And then he praises God himself. Notice with me in verse number 11, he immediately says, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. You know, I realize in our prayer life, one of the first things we should do is praise God. We should give adoration to him and thankfulness to him. And here's Peter. He says, you know what? We're going to prepare ourselves as suffering saints. We're going to understand Satan's coming with his scared tactics. But the truth of the matter is, God is going to take care of us in a great and powerful way. And as God has taken care of us in a great and powerful way, and he matures us and he establishes us and strengthens us and settles and supports us, as God does all those things, we need to give him the praise that is due his name. I know we usually come to the month of November and Thanksgiving, and some people will do 30 days of thanksfulness and thanksgiving and one different thought a day. But we should have a spirit of thanksgiving year round for what God has done. We should have a spirit of praise year round. And Peter says, hey, prepare yourself. Yes, the power of God, absolutely. But let's praise God for what he has done and what he's going to do. This is a future thing forever and ever. We get to praise God for what he is going to do. And then Peter comes to a peaceful hope that he leaves us. A peaceful hope. You know, I believe that we do need to understand that as believers, suffering saints, we need to be at peace with what the Lord has put in front of us. Look with me in these last few verses, verses 12 through 14. By Silvanus, or Silas, a faithful brother unto you, as I suppose, I've written briefly exhorting, testifying, that this is the true grace of God wherein. The church, as at Babylon, elected together with you, saluteth you, and so doth Mark, or Marcus, my son. And then he says, hey, greet ye one other with a kiss of charity. Peace be with you and all that are in Christ Jesus. And again, he says, amen. He gives a peaceful hope. It's one thing to be prepared for suffering. Another thing that we understand the power of God in suffering and understand the praise that we give to God. But we have a peaceful hope. Hope to live in peace. He acknowledges the team that put this together and helped him. Silas and Mark. Both counterparts of Paul in the ministry. And they are now with Peter as he encourages scattered believers and us today with this letter and this word. Not only the team he acknowledges the testifying side of things. He says, hey, keep sharing the faith. Keep testifying. Let others know of what God is accomplishing in your life. Let others know the power that God has in you and working in you. We tend to look backwards and say, well, this is the way it was. We want to get back to normal, but let's look forward and see what God has in store for us and thank him for what he's doing now in our lives, not just what he has done in the past and the distant past. He says, keep sharing the faith, testifying, and do it in togetherness. What do you mean, Pastor? Well, love, charity, encouraging each other. Our church used to do that fellowship time. We'd come together in the middle of worship. We'd sing a few songs and we'd sort of stop. And it was a transition. We moved our kids to kids' church and a nursery kid sort of went out at that time. And we had this fellowship time and the musicians played beautifully. And it would take 3 to 4 minutes. The center aisle would crowd up. People would be shaking everybody's hands. And it was almost a sin if you didn't shake everybody's hand during this 3.5, 4 minutes of time right in the middle of church. And I know some churches, man, they just despised it. When I first came, it was like, man, they're taking up my preaching time. And then I realized how much encouragement that time is. To be able to just have a quick show of affection, a shaking of hand, a hug, an encouraging smile, physical touch, appropriate, but loving. And Peter in their culture, he says, hey, listen, guys, here's what I want you to do. I want you to greet one another with a kiss of love. We understand that Peter was not intending anything wrong in that, but truly just an encouragement of togetherness. Being together with God's people. And so here is Peter giving us a peaceful hope. He sort of combats being alone to saying, hey, come together in peaceful hope. I do want to acknowledge just because it is there in Scripture, and some people may say, hey, what's the deal with this? Peter refers to the church that is at Babylon in verse 13. And some people believe that This is sort of a future statement of what's going to happen in the future. Others even give the idea that it was a code of deceit to throw off anybody that might read this, that they're trying to track Peter down. Peter will become a martyr, but it may be just a code to deceive people if they realize they're trying to track Peter down, who was probably still hiding in Jerusalem doing this. And he says, hey, here's the church at Babylon. It could be a reference to the ruins of the area, and maybe he was hiding in that area. Don't get caught up in that, please. Stay with the context of what's going on here in the passage. And it brings us to very simply this. As we suffer, we're going to be prepared, obviously, in a positive way. Understand Satan's coming. Accept the power of God and all grace. Praise Him through it that we have a peaceful hope. And as far as math goes, well, all this adds up together, just to be honest. Yeah, we can have some tricky math problems, but this adds up together. That Christ is helping us through the suffering, and we have a living, peaceful hope in Christ. I trust you'll be encouraged. I trust that you will accept the power of God. You'll praise Him and live in peace for Him. God bless you, and thank you for checking in with us at Mount Beulah Baptist Church. Have a blessed day.